for the last 10, 12 years, I'm doing expeditions all over the world. I have never filmed my expeditions because, of course, it was always a secret. And it's time to show the world how we start from scratch. How does a seed company should work, and where does he obtain his stuff that is grown outside? That's why we decided to go to all different regions to show where the original Malawi gold comes from. Santo, good care of us, huh?
Yes.
Malawi is a very, very special African country. I guess what makes it special is the wildlife, the beautiful scenery, but most importantly, the people. It's one of the poorest countries in the world. And I think it's number in the top 20 of the HIDP, which is the highly indebted poor countries. Also a very friendly country. They marketed it as the warm heart of Africa.
One of the reasons that I already for a long time wanted to visit Malawi is that I grew up in Africa and I'm a strain hunter, and I know that one of the best sativas grow in Malawi. An expedition like this, especially Malawi, is only possible with four-wheel drive cars, because it's rainy season. It rains between 200 and 400 mils a month. Maybe we should get out here, no? Let's get out here.
Yeah, man. I had 25 phone calls and 15 emails with the manager of Avis Lilongwe. And in the end, we arrived at the airport, and instead of a Toyota Hilux 4x4, they gave me a Toyota Corolla. The long walk, the longest walk of the whole week, for nothing. We got a 1.5 to 2 hours walk program officially. We start walking, we get to the first location, we find the group that is supposed to guide us to the second location, and on the way we start discovering that the 2 hours are becoming three.
The flat side there, yeah?
Yeah.
Is that where it is?
Yeah. And the 3 hours are becoming four.
Is it up the top, or do we have to walk all the way down to the rift?
And the hills are getting steeper and steeper and steeper.
Look, the most important thing, Tomo, is that if you are not sure about something, you have to let us know that you're not sure. It's fine, but don't let us think it's 1 hour, and then after 1 hour, it's another 45 minutes, and then after 45 minutes, it's another hour and a half, because it doesn't work.
We can't walk for 12 hours, mate. This is crazy. So we waste the whole day.
The walk was like longer than 6-7 hours, and we had to go back in the dark, and we didn't make it.
Sometimes that's what it takes. It cannot always go good. Sometimes you have to just keep walking for nothing.
Omar, good morning. This is Franco. I'm waiting. I'm part of the crew that is waiting for those two 4x4s. Eh? You confirm, eh? You confirm the vehicles are available today, yeah? Perfect.
How big? 3 hectares?
6
six hectares.
And how high are the plants now? High.
And the second day we start driving and I meet a very, very old contact of me called Isaac. He brought us to a really tiny, tiny village high up in the mountain. And we sat there for a while, talked to the local people, made our connection.
Look, you see this plant? This plant here, this ganja plant here. It's his plant.
Vicks, yes. Smells like Vicks. 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 The minty one, Vicks. The minty one, yes, he knows sativa, this guy.
This is from this year, it's fresh crop, huh?
And there we only had to walk 500 meters down into the bush, and there was this huge, huge field of 5-6 hectares in Malawi. Sam the Skunk Man, we find your stuff, mate. Huh?
Real woo-hoo! Malawi. This one. Really the size of the crystals.
You saw Simon, eh? Unbelievable, no?
It's marvelous.
This is very good, eh? This the resin that catches seed, no? You don't see this in Africa normally, so many resin on the plant. How many people you need for this to work? Because it's a lot of work, eh? 15 people you have from the village to clear all the weeds.
And that field really impressed me because it was for me the first time that I had the chance to see the Malawi gold growing in such a scale. So I could really see many special characteristics of the plants on a big scale, on a good volume for statistical watch.
This is monkeys just eat hemp here and get stoned. It's funny, eh? And the baboons, is a problem? They take a lot or? Because I can see everywhere a little bit baboon damage, eh? They eat it? And then they make party. Yeah. Party.
Wild party.
Yeah? If you go into an area like Malawi and you meet a lot of people, you see growth for 20 years, you see growth for 10 years, and you see growth for 1 or 2 years. Most of the time they're a little bit scared and not allowed to say to you from their family or the community how long they grow. As a strain hunter, you really have to make sure that you know who is doing what, because often you can see that the not so good grower is also the guy who hasn't obtained a very good seeds to grow his next year crop.
Growers in Malawi are very resourceful people. They are very poor people. They are people who use everything they can to maintain their family and their children.
The reason why they call it Malawi gold is that this crop, yeah, it is rare, just like gold.
Yeah.
You can't find it any other way or no. In other country.
Okay.
And this, with just a little, you can fetch much money.
That's what makes them good growers, the need for survival. These guys don't know nothing. They don't know how to speak English almost. But they know things about the plants that are pretty amazing.
Did you ever try to give fertilizer to the plants? Yeah, the charcoal they use as fertilizer, yeah.
Some of them are already so advanced that they actually pull their males. Some of them are so advanced that they actually know they have two phenotypes in their field, even if they don't know the meaning of the word phenotype in English.
Hey, when did you plant this? When did you plant?
Oh, that's about January.
January.
January 20.
20 January.
20 January.
And when you harvest?
May.
May, 20 May.
Yeah.
4 months.
Yeah.
So you have 4 months of harvest.
You can see that a lot of them use agricultural techniques that are borrowed from other industries. You can see that, for example, they try to plant the ganja field the same way that the cassava fields are planted. And you can also see that what they do is a very sophisticated thing called inbreeding. And that means to completely isolate one strain, one genetic, and let it only reproduce with itself, like in one single family.
And you always use your own seeds?
No.
Okay, they do have their own seeds.
Their own seeds.
Yeah.
They take out and they plant every year.
Yeah.
So these seeds are very, very old. This is maybe already 100 generations then.
And these people are doing that even without realizing, because they have one place, and that's so far away from any other place, that the seeds they make every year are completely inbred seeds.
Yeah, very good job, eh?
Yeah. Very good job, man. Yeah, yeah. I am seriously impressed by this.
How long you grow?
Thank you very much.
Thank you, man.
You're a good farmer.
Yeah. You are a serious farmer. Respect, bro.
It's a perfect place.
You make the world happy. What a dream would it be to have it feel like this in Europe.
Yeah, man, imagine.
You see how small we are, eh?
Yeah.
Hey. And now you can see how they pushed to indoor.
Yeah.
Outdoor will be much nicer, but they really pushed to indoor. For us, it's also nice to see actually what's not possible in Europe anymore. In Europe, because the war on drugs went so crazy with all the Christian parties and other people against us, everything moved indoor.
Indoor growing is for sure against nature. So people grow indoor when they cannot grow outdoor, because we all know it's scientifically proven that the best marijuana in the world is grown under the sun.
So what happens now in my country, we all have like 10-20 lights, and we grow under the lights and grow in a certain kind of indoor pot that a lot of time is used with the wrong chemicals, not flushed properly, has not the right taste.
There is no indoor light that can replicate the sunlight. So the range of cannabinoids and terpenes that can develop in the marijuana resin, thanks to the sunlight, is never achievable on an indoor setting.
The governments in Europe really pushed to grow indoor because we have no choice.
And to waste the electricity and to create
electricity,
more pollution.
To create pollution to all kinds of things.
This actually is offsetting CO2, this whole field.
Yeah.
On the other hand, indoor, you can really control your environment. When you grow outdoor, you can never grow scientifically. So to study the marijuana plant and to genetically develop it, to create new strains, it is necessary to work indoor as well. You cannot do it by only doing it outdoor. But my heart always tells me the best marijuana in the world is outdoor marijuana.
And when you come back here, you see the love of the people and the passion. And at the same time, the whole community is living on it. You see outdoor pot growing in soil that's absolutely not fertilized. Sometimes they use charcoal, that's only thing they use, and the plants are beautiful green and have a beautiful taste and a beautiful high. The big difference is that the pot outside is not as strong as the pot inside, but has a much better taste that I personally prefer. So yeah, smoking pot in Africa is great, and especially in Malawi, where we had great evenings smoking the Malawi Gold.
So what we have here is an original Malawi cob, and let's have a look what's inside. There you go, the original Malawi cob.
No, it's complex.
Not bad. Check it out. Not bad.
Nice. It's got that woody smell there.
Yeah. It's not really fermented actually. Yeah? Mm. I thought it would ferment more in the cup. That's cool.
It's quite good.
So we're gonna taste it soon.
It's a good pick for morning. Yeah.
Now we have very good.
It's the best from Africa.
Yeah, best from Africa, like from Malawi originally.
The third day we went on, another contact of us in Nakota Bay. We call them James Brown, James Brown.
Okay, yeah. You guys come, we go.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Thanks.
Okay.
The Mali is
down. Hi, it's him.
Yeah.
How are you doing, man?
I remember the guy.
Everything nice okay?
What's up? Nice to see you.
How's his plans?
The rest are being cut by some thieves.
By some thieves?
Yeah, they stole it.
They stole his money.
Ganja's been a plant that was always here, but ganja growing in the end and in our current context is a survivalist thing. People do it to survive. Malawi and many parts of southern Africa, it's been a survivalist thing that people can do to make money and feed their families.
We are making fun of this oil for food program that came during the 90s in the Middle East, where basically they were telling people that in the end the oil was supposed to feed them and really give them what we never had. We are doing that with cannabis. Cannabis is doing that itself with all the poorest people of the planet. Basically it's a crop that can save the children of the poorest areas of the planet, and the people perceive the crop as a positive one. They know it's a plant, they know it's not a poison, they know it's not a hard drug, they know that it's just a way to keep their families alive without harming the planet. Oh yeah.
Slowly now, the world has come to a conclusion that we can see that the big success of us comes due to feminized seeds. Feminized seeds is a crop that says itself already, it's only feminized plants. The big advantage of feminized plants is that you have a very stable crop, homogenetic totally, and you could say for like 90%, and you don't have any males. So it will be very, very nice in the future, and I think it will take maybe another 10 years, but you will see in the future that farmers in poor areas will start growing feminized crops for their community and to gain much more money to send their children to school and to develop their houses in their community.
Look, he made hash. Wow, Malana.
Whoa, man.
Where's the money?
That's really good, my
this
man.
This is,
wow. Oh.
He made it.
Finger, eh? Finger
he
hash.
Him off.
Like
him, yeah.
Wow.
He really did it, man.
I tell, this is the first Malana
he
hash.
He really did it, man.
Look at this, man. Wow.
Damn.
Charas from
Malawi. Malawi black.
That doesn't even exist, mate.
I think you
We created this.
I think you are amazing. It's good. Amazing, man, for listening to the king and making the real.
You like?
This is
too strong, huh?
Too strong, eh?
James Brown and Nelson, really, really nice guys. It was quite frustrating and hard when we finally got there and found that all or everything had been cut down. It happens in Africa, we could understand it, but I was a bit frustrated with the two guys.
Yeah, guys, and we have been walking for four hours for this field. Yeah, and I already told you, make sure that we go to a field, yeah?
To get there, to walk so far and then find a few plants was a little bit disappointing, but particularly when you got the king and Franco.
And it must be like three times this size to say it's a field. You understand?
Yeah.
One of the guys apparently didn't check the fields properly, and we went walking and walking up, down, and it was a very, very rainy day. We had a real kind of tropical mousson, and walking up and down the hills, and we saw some plants, but not much.
How far away is the next field from here?
James Brown and Nelson did a lot of damage to our expedition because they cost us like 1.5 days, but they also did some good because in the end, they took us back to that one grower where a few months ago we found the most amazing, amazing single plant that up to now I saw in Malawi. And thanks to James Brown, in the end, we have the genetics. So we forgive James Brown.
the big mountains popping up. Look.
Yeah, see that's it? Where we're going.
What we did now, we first did a little bit the south, then we did the middle, and now we're going to the north. And you see the diversity of the genetics in the different areas already.
Absolutely.
We are the only ones who are really, really looking for the wild land races in countries and bringing this back and crossing this. But I think it's really, really time to share this with everybody who wants to have it. So what I would suggest to do is make this big genetic wall on the fairs, make a few hundred crosses. For example, here we have the Malawi Gold. So we make it in pure form.
And then throw everything we have on it.
So what we will do is we make all kinds of bags and put in like 20 seeds, and we will have stable rice and unstable strains, hybrids, and we will just give this to people and make sure everybody can share this, because
that way we can use the expertise and the logistics of our customers, and they can help us getting much
because
more.
We already have 1800 crosses of hybrids in the fridge lying, and we have no time to grow it out. It's so much, you know, it's better to start sharing this with people.
Yeah, how many times you open that fridge and I start drooling and telling you, hey man, let's take that out, hey, let's use that. And
maybe use 100 strains from the 1800s.
Never have time.
And, you know, you have no space, you need 10,000 lights to do it and you don't have them. So I think we should start making a genetic wall.
Vincent, who is the brother of Tomo, who I used as an assistant during the whole trip, and we tried to help his family out with all kinds of stuff. In previous trips, he asked me to bring his brother along because his brother wanted to go to the universities to study medicine. So we decided to pay his fee for the first year, and we took him along.
What's up? What's up?
We got a little problem. I need you to phone and help me, because apparently James Brown and Vincent were arrested last night in Kota Kota for being out too late past the curfew. So we just
want
to find out where they are, if they're still in custody, whatever, whatever.
Over. We had to drop off Vincent in Nakota Bay, and apparently an ambulance got hijacked there. And the police was looking out for the robbers of this ambulance. And all the young guys that were walking on the street got arrested and thrown in prison.
Well, fortunately, when I got there, they were free. And all I had to do was pay a few little bribes and also replace the $100 which they'd received in tip money, which was, of course, really, really important for them.
Hey, Nelson. Hey, what time they leave?
Yeah, it's after.
How many people in the car? Three. Perfect. I know enough. Everyone out. Okay. Okay, cool, my man. Ciao.
Okay.
Rock in.
How are you, sir?
Thank you. How are you?
Very good.
Thank you. My name is James.
James?
Yes, please.
Not nice James Brown?
No, James Musisha.
When Simon finally pulled him out and came back to us and everything seemed to be fine, we go look for the next guy. We had an appointment with Peter, and apparently Peter is in jail as well.
These things all happen on a trip like this.
Yeah, that's the area for sure.
We decided, because Peter was not available, to go on our own. So what we did, we arrived at the village from Mr. Banda. The crop was stolen by people. So unfortunately, also that crop was not available anymore. So we went back in the mud and in the rain. It was a terrible trip.
I've been stuck in some places in my life, but like you get stuck in Africa, there is no way of getting stuck anywhere else. Because the mud is just different here. It's just this mix of clay and sand and the evil of the devil in it.
And in these situations, you all can see how fragile a big expedition is to find something. Something can go really, really small wrong, and the next 2 days you're stuck and you're gonna miss out on your big fields or other things.
I was struggling. I was really thinking we were gonna spend a night there. But thank God we got out.
We all know anyway that the area where Isaac is, that is the area of Malawi where the best stuff grows. So we spent another day there and then we went back to Isaac, who in the meantime located a few other fields for us to find the original Malawi gold. What? With table?
And then we give special food. This special food, fertilizers.
Yeah, mafuta. Yeah.
Isaac was the real link because Isaac was really the guy that the growers trusted. The growers didn't trust Tomo, the growers didn't trust Vincent or Nelson or James Brown. Not even me and Arjan, because they just don't know us. But the growers trusted Isaac.
Isaac was our gem. In fact, a lot of the large fields that we eventually accessed was through Isaac. The other guys were often talk, a bit of exaggeration. Isaac never exaggerated. In the end, we saw umpteen fields because of his connections. Really liked Isaac.
The bags are opening, Arjan. It's dry,
eh? Look at the seeds, eh?
Loads of seeds.
Fucking nice,
man. Let's separate.
I'm gonna steal that bag, yeah?
Sure.
I'm gonna run away with the bag, watch this. I go!
Nice hard and dry, eh? Mm-hmm. Wow, we got it all, eh?
King, huh? I have no words to express my feeling. This is the real deal.
The guy really pulled it off, eh?
We really pulled it off. It was actually the first time in the All Malawi mission that a group of guys so rough in the middle of nowhere gave me the feeling of really having covered, organized, completely organizing what they do.
Oh man, I envy these guys.
Real guerrilla style, eh?
Real.
But you see also they go away. And in 4 weeks, the grass is up again, they put it down again. Yeah. They can move quickly, you know? They just take another hill.
It's a whole flexible, serious operation here, man. Really pros, these guys.
Let's walk to the fields, guys.
Yeah, let's go up.
Patch here, eh?
Wow.
And you see the same farmers, they put also again here, they put this patch of seeds down.
Yeah, and then nature does the selection.
And nature does the selection.
May the strongest survive.
Can you ask him why this patch is greener?
Because it's different patch.
Different, you put more charcoal in the ground here.
Yeah.
Ah, he fertilized this ground a little bit with charcoal.
You can see.
Yeah.
This one is really
look at the internodes here.
Uniform and
from
steady.
Here, 1, 2, 3, steady. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And then here full it gets blast. A little shorter, you see in the top.
And look at the competition already of the
fourth, fifth set of branches already. It's over half the plant already climbing up to compete. Really solid genetic.
And she's still pretty green, for the end of the crop, because they're gonna harvest now.
Yeah, but that's also because of their system. You could stretch this one more.
Yeah. But that's because they put the seeds in, so it finished off early.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
But he pulled all his males, eh?
Yeah.
See that, eh? Took all his males away.
There's not one male here. They're too late. They're just too late.
But
they don't recognize them on time.
Well, what is the thing is here, they just sell it with seeds. That's how it comes. Because you know why? Because if the seeds are in the pot, it's heavier.
Yeah.
So they get more money for the thing. And they need the seeds for next year. So they just do the seed thing here, you know? This is how it all works all over Africa. You'll see that.
Demand and supply.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Let's walk a little to the other side.
Okay. It was a smooth walk. It was not too steep. And we get to this beautiful, beautiful field. Really amazing location. Perfect, perfect sun exposition with the greatest soil. Very, very, very good fertilized. This guy burned trees. They improved the soil with ashes to give the extra P and K for the flowering.
Serious formation on this one.
It's good. We got all the seeds from this area. Now look how beautiful, man.
Nah, this is serious production on this. Much more than the other ones. And here, I would say the internode stays even a little shorter.
Yeah.
I see two finos in this field. I see this is more fruity, and the leaf is a little more pointy, and the other one is stronger branching, longer internode a little bit, a little bit more, less pointy leaf, and in the end, woodier.
What do you think, Sai?
Incredible.
Nice, eh?
Just goes on and on.
Check it out. Woody one, fruity one.
Yeah.
And the branching is much more solid and the internode longer on the woody one.
Yeah, it's funny.
It's funny, eh?
But look, the leaves, look at the leaves here.
Two styles of plants.
Look, I show you the leaves. Look at the difference.
Let me see.
The one is slimmer than the other.
Yeah, full on.
You see that?
Full on. The thicker one is the more woody one. And the thinner one is the more fruity one. That's the funny part. Because you would imagine the fruitier one has more indica in it. But it's actually the one with the more sativa leaf. This is really genetically very, very interesting field. Huh? And you see that only the fruity one gets the red on the stems. And the woody one doesn't. Stays green, the stem. Only the fruity one gets the red lines. The thick red lines. Transportation highways.
Yeah, she's so
very interesting.
Franco, I got a virus here. Look.
Tell me. Yeah, totally.
You see the virus? A very 100%. Slim. Well, it's not a virus, it's a bacteria actually.
Yeah, interaction.
But you see, compared to the healthy plant.
Yeah.
It loses. It gets this. You see the cut of the leaf also here. Mm-hmm. Exactly, the cut of the leaf goes away and it gets very slim and it gets light yellow and it dies.
And also the texture gets crunchy. You can almost crunch it. It's
oh, I got bitten again. Beautiful, eh? It's so perfect.
Really beautiful.
Frankie coming?
Absolutely.
Simon saw a patch on the other side. It's apparently really nice, like everything here. This is a real strain, man. Here the strain hunters find something really, really,
really worth hunting.
Yeah.
Worth walking hours and hours in the jungle.
This is the one. Look at this. The Malawi Gold.
Yeah.
Here it is.
Once we saw the first field, we even got the chance to get to the second field. And the second field was actually the most amazing I've seen in the entire mission. Because there you could really see that all the factors that one grower was able to do that, the other grower was able to do that, the other grower was able to finish up with the final touch, and they put it all together in one place.
Now this place had really everything. It had the right technique of planting, the right spread out of genetics, the seedlings were germinated properly, the males were being pulled out in the right time. So for me it was really nice to see that even though they don't really know how to do it in an organized way, it comes down on a quite organized way for them.
There's a pineapple thing again.
Yeah, that's it, huh?
There's a few of those in the field that we find, eh?
That's sweet.
Yeah, that's the new stuff we're gonna use to breed.
Yeah, absolutely, that's what.
This is really, really, really something very particular. I've never seen this before. Yeah, we should test this in the laboratory for the turpers and see what comes out here, but this is really, really very interesting. Put some seeds away.
We bring it back, you know, we work with it, see what comes out.
I don't know any haze right now.
That has the full,
that has the full pineapple thing. You know, you can talk about mango and you can talk about, well, if it's strawberry,
cantaloupe, whatever.
You know, we should make it pure, in a pure form.
Yeah, absolutely.
So people can breed with it. So we make feminized Malawi gold seeds. And the best one we can pick out indoor. Yeah. And we should cross it all.
We let people select for us.
And then we let people select for us. They put a thread on the internet.
Yeah,
give seeds. And give the seeds for free and put it in our gene bank and see what comes out. Yeah. Because this is fabulous, huh?
Pineapple, anyone?
People are gonna freak out, man. People that love the fruity stuff, they're gonna lose it.
Anything interesting up there, Simon?
This goes up and up and up and up.
Very interesting.
More treasures.
But I think we saw like now 20 fields in Malawi, and all of them are different, eh? All farmers are different, all they grow all different.
Much more variety than expected. Much more variety. Yeah. Also in the same field where it's been inbreeding and inbreeding again for God knows how many hundreds years of inbreeding, still you see the 2-3 lines and beautiful uniform in between themselves. Really amazing.
Well, I think we find enough to make the world happy on seeds here. I think we have a lot of new stuff to work.
A lot of work for the
lot of new work for the next few years, because here the original Malawi gold should really, really come back. It's so nice. I think everybody should go back to smoking sativa. But yeah, you know my opinion. Eh? You want to smoke indicas while you also
don't
smoke
bring
sativas.
Me back in the discussion again.
I want this.
How many times
everyone,
we go to
I want
this
everybody
discussion.
To smoke this I mean, this thing. I want everybody to be high, and I don't want everybody to be stoned. I want
there's the moment to be high. There's the moment to be stoned. I want there's a moment for the whiskey. There's a moment for the red wine. Yeah?
There's always. Anyway.
The Malawian expedition was really, really special. It was a privilege to be with the King and Franco and to find what we did find.
The Malawi mission has been a great success. It's been very difficult, very harsh on the equipment and on us, but we accomplished it, we did it.
It was a very, very successful trip for us. We have seen huge fields from 4, 5, 6 hectares of Malawi gold. We have brought back different batches of seeds from all different regions, and it was very successful. We got all the seeds and all the phenotypes we wanted to breed with for the future.
Wait just a second, I'll change the picture. You look very nice.
Yeah. We are going with these guys to Kanja Plantation.
Maybe next year I come again. I come look you up, eh? Because you are the best.
Go to school and the community. Godwin Onyanga passed away 10 years ago. Wow. Although he is kissing the earth, but he is still speaking
through his wise technology, the basket bridge,
the basket
you have come to see.
Yes.